Hello everyone, we will be discussing cisplatin in this lecture. The cytotoxicity of cisplatin, it's dependent upon its structure. Cis-diamine dichloroplatinum, as we can see, platinum in the center and two amine groups and two chloride groups on the same side. Platinum exists primarily in either a 2+ or a 4+ oxidation state. These oxidation states dictate the stereochemistry of the ligands surrounding the platinum atom. Platinum compounds exhibit a square planar geometry in which the amine ligands, also called the carrier groups, are relatively stable, whereas the opposite, more polar ligands, the leaving groups, which are the chlorides, they are more easily displaced and confer reactivity towards charged macromolecules including DNA. The stereochemistry of platinum complexes is critical to their anti-tumor activity, as evidenced by the significantly reduced efficacy observed with trans-diamine dichloroplatinum. In aqueous solution, the chloride leaving groups of cisplatin are subject to mono and di-aqua substitution, particularly at chloride concentrations below 100 mmol, which characterize the intracellular environment. Administration of cisplatin in high chloride solutions, normally saline solutions, therefore contributes to stability. Intracellular formation of partially and fully aquated complexes creates the chloraqua and hydroxyaqua cisplatin species that bind DNA. I will be explaining the mechanism of action of cisplatin, but before that, shortly we must understand the structure of DNA. As we know that DNA is made up of a sugar, a deoxyribose sugar, a phosphate, and a nitrogen base. And there are two strands which are antiparallel to each other. Adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine are the nitrogen bases. And among them, A and G are the purine, and C and T are the pyrimidine. So what does a pyrimidine ring look like? It is just like a benzene ring with two nitrogen atoms. And an imidazole ring is a 5-atom ring with 2 nitrogen and 2 double bonds. How is a purine then made? Purine is made with the combination of a pyrimidine ring with an imidazole ring. As we can see here, the structure of adenine, which is a purine, which looks like a combination of a pyrimidine and an imidazole ring. So this is important to know because the reactivity of cisplatin is mainly with the N7 carbon, which I have circled here. As you can see, in guanine also, the N7 reacts with the platinum of the cisplatin. So this is how the reaction takes place. The N7 atom of guanine attacks the platinum and then the chloride is displaced away. And in this way, a bond is formed between the guanine and the cisplatin. Another guanine then attaches with the cisplatin and another chloride is then displaced. In this way, there are formed the crosslinks, which are the intra-strand crosslinks and the inter-strand crosslinks. What is important to know here is that, most importantly, the links which are formed are on the same DNA are on the same strand of DNA, and usually maximum of them are between guanine and guanine. So we call them as PG-PG. So 65% of the intra-strand crosslinks are between two guanine bases. After that, we find that there are PA-PG intra-strand crosslinks. As we can see here, that a crosslink is formed between adenine and guanine on the same DNA strand, which is about 22%. It is important to know that whereas PA-PG is formed, but there is no crosslinking between PG and PA. It means if adenine is above guanine, there will be a crosslink formed, but not otherwise, not in a vice versa. And it is also important to know that interstrand crosslinks, which is the crosslinking between and nitrogen bases of both the DNA strands, is very less as compared to the intrastrand crosslinks. So once the cross-linking is formed, what is the effect that we see in the cell? As we know that if once the there is a cross-link formed, so there will be decreased transcription and it will result to decreased protein synthesis. And also there will be decreased DNA replication and ultimately there will be decreased cell division. So this is the mechanism how cisplatin acts at the cellular level. Now another thing which the cross-linking does is it activates the kinases ATM and ATR, which is ataxia telangiectasia mutated and ataxia telangiectasia and RAD3 related protein. So these kinases in turn activate the checkpoint kinase 1 and 2, which are the CHK1 and CHK2. What happens normally in the cell is that whenever P53 is formed, so MDM2 attaches to the P53 and ubiquitinates the P53. And once P53 is ubiquitinated, it goes through the proteasome and P53 is cleaved, so that P53 cannot usually act in a normal cell. But when CHK1 and CHK2 are formed, they phosphorylate the P53 so that it does not undergo the cleavage in the proteasome. In this way, P53 also acts in the apoptosis mechanism in the cell. Now we will see what is the mechanism of resistance to cisplatin in a cell. So various mechanisms have been described. One of them are decreased platinum accumulation, cisplatin inactivation, increased platinum DNA adduct repair, or platinum DNA damage tolerance. We will see what is the reduced accumulation. So platinum uptake in the cells occurs by simple diffusion and by carrier mediated mechanisms. Inhibition of transport mechanisms has a marked effect on intracellular platinum accumulation. The copper transporters 1 and 2, CTR1 and CTR2, regulate the influx of various platinum analogs in the eukaryotic cells. Accumulation may also be influenced by enhanced efflux, and various transport proteins are upregulated in the cell lines selected for acquired resistance and in platinum resistant ovarian cancers. So cisplatin can also be inactivated inside the cell. So platinum complexes are highly reactive molecules and bind rapidly to multiple cellular macromolecules. So protection from such chemicals in the environment is afforded by cellular thiols, including small peptides such as GSH and larger proteins as exemplified by metallothionine, MT. And platinum drug sensitivity and GSH levels are inversely related. Increased DNA repair. The repair of platinum DNA adducts appears to occur predominantly by nucleotide excision repair, with a role for mismatch repair under certain circumstances. Once platinum DNA adducts are formed, cells must either repair or tolerate the damage to survive. The molecular basis for the increased repair activity observed in cisplatin-resistant cells is not known precisely, but formation of the ERCC1 XPF protein complex may be a key step. Another mechanism is the restoration of homologous recombination. So in carriers of deleterious BRCA1, BRCA2 mutations, sensitivity to platinum agents depends on the inability of the tumor cells to perform the homologous recombination. Reactivation of the function of the BRCA2 gene leads to the restoration of homologous recombination. This reactivation is accomplished by an intragenic deletion and the restoration of an open reading frame. Coming to the pharmacokinetics of cisplatin. After IV infusion, cisplatin rapidly diffuses into the tissues and is covalently bound to the plasma and other proteins. More than 90% of the platinum is bound to plasma protein at 4 hours after infusion. The disappearance of ultrafiltrable platinum is rapid and occurs in a biphasic fashion. Ultrafiltrable platinum is the platinum which is not bound to the serum proteins. Half-life of 10 to 30 minutes and 0.7 to 0.8 hours have been reported for the initial and terminal phases respectively. Cisplatin excretion is dependent on renal function, which accounts for the majority of its elimination. The percentage of platinum excreted in the urine has been reported to be between 23% and 40% at 24 hours after infusion. The remainder remains protein bound for very long periods, with the total serum platinum level declining with a median half-life of 3.7 years. Only a small percentage of the total platinum is excreted in the bile. What are the interactions of cisplatin? So, various interaction of cisplatin are known. So, interaction with etoposide. So, there is synergistic antineoplastic activity against testicular, small cell lung and non-small cell lung cancer. And it possibly, the mechanism involved is the possible impaired elimination of etoposide in patients previously treated with cisplatin. So, as we know that cisplatin is a nephrotoxic drug. So, there is increased risk of nephrotoxicity when it is combined with other nephrotoxic agents like aminoglycoside and amphotericin. And it is, as we know that cisplatin is also an ototoxic drug. So, it also increased, there is also an increased risk of ototoxicity when combined with ototoxic drugs like aminoglycosides or loop diuretics. Then, its interaction with phenytoin. So, cisplatin decreases the phenytoin levels in the serum, and so we must consider to increase the dose of phenytoin in this situation. And pyridoxine is known to decrease the cisplatin activity. And as we know that cisplatin paclitaxel is a commonly used combination. So, whenever cisplatin and paclitaxel are given together, paclitaxel must always be given before cisplatin is administered, and this sequence prevents the delayed paclitaxel excretion and increased toxicity. The nephrotoxic effects of cisplatin is inactivated by amifostine and mesna. So, there are two modes of administration of cisplatin. As we know, one is the intravenous and another is the HIPEC, which is the hyperthermic intraperitoneal chemotherapy, and pump solution into the abdominal cavity and circulate as per protocol using hyperthermia pump, and solutions and dwell time vary by protocol. Coming to the toxicity of cisplatin, as you know that nephrotoxicity is the most common toxicity, and it has to be dealt with cautiously. So, renal dysfunction due to cisplatin may manifest as renal insufficiency, hypokalemia and hypomagnesemia. The risk for these adverse effects is related to the dose and interval of cisplatin and may be minimized by adequate hydration. Fluid status of the patient is critical, and patients must be hydrated before, during and post drug administration. Usual approach is to give at least 1 liter before and 1 liter post drug administration of 0.9% NaCl with 20 milliequivalents of KCl. And with higher doses of drug, more aggressive hydration should be considered, with at least 2 liter of fluid administered before drug. And in this setting, urine output should be greater than 100 milliliter per hour. And furosemide diuresis may be used after every 2 liter of fluid. So basically, we must consider for adequate hydration and then forced diuresis to prevent the nephrotoxicity of cisplatin. So various, what are the dosages that must be dealt with in renal failure? Whenever we administer cisplatin, we must evaluate the creatinine, serum creatinine levels in the patient, and accordingly calculate the creatinine clearance. And whenever it is equal to or more than 60 milliliter per minute, 100% dose of creatinine can be given. If it is between 45 to 59, then 75% of the dose calculated can be given, or we can go for carboplatin. And if it is less than 45, we must avoid giving cisplatin until the creatinine clearance improves, or we can go for carboplatin in this situation. And adequate hydration of, as I said, that has to be done always. And the hydration depends on the dosage given. With more intense hydration done for higher levels, and less intense for lower dosage of cisplatin. And adequate KCl and MgSO4 have to be added. And forced diuresis can be given with mannitol. Another effect is the otic effect, which includes the tinnitus with or without clinical hearing loss and occasional deafness. Ototoxicity is cumulative and irreversible and results from damage to the inner ear. Initially there is a loss of high frequency acuity, 4000 to 8000 hertz, and when acuity is affected in the range of speech, cisplatin should be discontinued. So another important side effect of cisplatin is nausea and vomiting, and as we know that there is an acute and there is a delayed nausea and vomiting. So acute is within the first 24 hours and begins within usually 1 hour of starting of therapy and may last for 8 to 12 hours, and delayed is usually after 24 hours, and it will occur in more than 90% of the patients if antiemetics are not given. And cisplatin is a highly emetogenic drug. So before chemotherapy, a pre-medication must consist of a 5-HT3 receptor antagonist like ondansetron and plus dexamethasone plus NK1 antagonist and olanzapine. And after chemotherapy, dexamethasone plus olanzapine for 2 to 4 days can be considered to decrease the incidence of late onset or delayed nausea vomiting. Myelosuppression is another toxicity which will occur in almost 25 to 30% of the patients, and WBC nadir will occur at 18 to 23 days and platelet nadir at 18 to 23 days with recovery in 39 days. Anemia is observed with cisplatin, may be caused by a decrease in erythropoietin or the erythroid stem cells. Cisplatin has been shown to sensitize the red blood cells, sometimes resulting in a direct Coombs positive hemolytic anemia. Neurotoxicity is usually in the form of peripheral sensory neuropathy, paresthesias and numbness in a classic stocking glove pattern, and tends to occur after several cycles of therapy, and risk increases with cumulative doses. Loss of motor function, focal encephalopathy and seizures also observed. Neurologic effects may be irreversible. So there are known, cisplatin is also known to cause anaphylaxis reaction. So it can consist of facial edema, flushing, wheezing, respiratory difficulties, tachycardia and hypotension. And these reactions can occur within a few minutes after IV administration, diaphoresis, nasal stuffiness, rhinorrhea, conjunctivitis, generalized erythema, apprehension and sensation of chest constriction may also occur. Cisplatin-induced anaphylactoid reactions usually have occurred after multiple cycles of cisplatin, like at least after 5 doses, but also can occur after the first dose. Some reactions may also be due to the mannitol that is given with cisplatin to prevent the nephrotoxicity. Occasionally, patients who experienced anaphylactoid reactions have been safely retreated with cisplatin following the pretreatment with corticosteroids or antihistamines. However, such prophylaxis is not uniformly effective in preventing the recurrence. So as I said that it can cause ocular toxicity, and there can also be a transient elevation in the LFTs, mainly the SGOT and serum bilirubin, but we need not alter the dose of cisplatin due to the altered LFT. There can be alopecia and SIADH. Regarding fertility, and cisplatin is known to cause temporary infertility in majority of the patients, and among males receiving cisplatin for testicular cancer, almost all become azoospermic within the first two cycles of therapy, but recovery of normal sperm morphology, motility and sperm count occurs in 40% within 1.5 to 2 years. So cisplatin is a FDA pregnancy category D, so there is positive evidence of human fetal risk, but the benefits from the use in pregnant women may be acceptable despite the risk. For example, if the drug is needed in a life-threatening situation or for a serious disease for which safer drugs cannot be used or are ineffective. And breastfeeding is not recommended as cisplatin is excreted in human milk. So these are the various uses, as we already know, of cisplatin. Thank you.